general purpose computing system and the embedded system. See, actually, when you see the general purpose computing computing system, it is a combination of a generic hardware and a general purpose operating system for executing a variety of applications. Here, the operating system, it is not designed for a specific purpose. Whereas when you see the embedded system, so here the operating system, it is designed to perform a specific type of functionality. When you see the, for example, washing machine, so here whatever the functionalities he give, so it is with respect to whatever the features he gives, it is only with respect to the washing. Okay, so those systems are designed for the specific purpose. And here, when you see the general purpose computing system, so it requires an operating system. Where the general systems, it requires an operating system. Some of the examples of the general purpose operating systems are like Microsoft Windows, Google Android, Linux, Mac OS. So these are all the examples of the general purpose operating systems. Okay. Whereas in case of the embedded systems, it may or may not contain the operating system. Okay, it is not compulsory. So when you see the small scale devices, you know, for example, just a electronic toy, it does not require any operating system. Suppose when you see some higher end devices, definitely it requires the operating system. Some of the embedded operating system include Symbian operating system, so which is used in the old Nokia phones, embedded Linux, BlackBerry operating system, which is used in the BlackBerry systems, and other examples include Windows IoT and all. And when you see the Google Android, so it is an example for the general purpose operating system, because the thing is, so today's smartphones, when you consider, it is no more, it is an embedded device, because it is actually can perform multiple functionalities, and it is more than an embedded device. Almost it is like a general purpose computing system, right? And the third difference is, so here, when you see the embedded device, so here, its behavior need not to be needs to be deterministic only in case of the special applications, that is hard real-time systems. See, when you see the hard real-time systems, these are the systems in which the safety is very critical. So these are the systems. Airbag control, okay, airbag control in the car. See, when you see this airbag control, so here the output must be very deterministic, you know. It needs to work at the exact time. Here the delay is not acceptable. I mean, it should not, within a fraction of a second, whenever the car hits a particular, the airbag must be open. So here the delay is not acceptable. Whereas when you see the general purpose systems, so here also we will not tell that something like here the output should not be deterministic, we should not test, but the thing is, it is acceptable. So whenever you get the output which is not acceptable, okay, it's fine, you can just recheck the program and you can execute it in a different way, fine. Whereas in case of the embedded system, that too in case of the hard real-time applications, it should not happen. And also, the response time is very critical. The fourth difference is, the response time is very critical in case of the embedded system, especially the machine critical systems, you know, because if the response time, if the system does not respond in time, there will be a huge business loss. So some of the examples, like for example, you know, online ticket booking system, or even, many banking transactions. So whenever there is a delay, for example, when a particular person books a ticket, he has already paid the amount. So if that place is not blocked, if some other person, if he books the same seat, it is definitely, it's a conflict, and there will be a huge business loss. The people will not trust it anymore and they will not use. So here in case of the mission critical systems, so here the response time will be very important. Whereas in the general purpose systems, as I told, it is important to have the response time correct, but the thing is, it is not critical. It means there will be no any business loss kind of things, fine. And one more thing, the fifth difference is, so here when you are designing the general purpose computing system, you know, so here the designing factors are like performance. Always we will go for the systems which is having the better speed. Whereas when you see the embedded system, when you are designing the embedded system, so here the key factors will be the power, cost, size and speed. Exactly, because, you know, when you see some of the embedded system like a wearable device, like for example, the smart band. So here, the size is very important. You cannot design the smart band which is having the huge weight. So in that case, whatever the hardware that you are using, so it must be having the minimal weight, and you cannot use the higher memory in this one. Fine. So depending upon the, and also the power usage. So when you are designing the smart bands, so you cannot design the smart bands which uses more power. Okay, so here in this case, actually, the power usage is also very important. So some of the metrics that will be considered when you are designing the embedded system, in case of when you are designing the embedded system, it will be like power, cost, speed, and size. Whereas in case of the general purpose operating system, so only the performance is a key factor. Fine. So now the last difference is the embedded system, whatever the software that is there, we cannot alter that one. Okay, whatever the program it is there, just we can use the features that they have provided. So we cannot alter that. Okay, so we cannot alter the software. Whereas in case of the general purpose computing system, always we can just change the operating system, or we can reinstall that. We can add many features into that one. We can use, change the applications. That is possible in case of the general purpose computing system. Whereas in the embedded system, definitely it is not possible. So just we have to use the features, whatever they have provided, right? See, actually, this question is very important. Okay, as I have already told you, this module 3, 4, 5, it is new topic actually in computer science. I expect this question, right? So now let us see one more topic. See, actually, when you see the when I have given you the examples of the embedded system, I have given some of the examples based on the applications. Okay, so these are the different applications in and I have given the examples based on these applications. For example, when you see this healthcare, okay, so when you see the healthcare, so here so one example I have given is the ECG machine. So what is the use of that ECG machine? What is the purpose of the ECG machine? What it does is exactly it will just monitor the heart rate, right? So it will be having the few sensors. From the sensors, it will just read the heart rate and it will display on the monitor. So the purpose of the ECG is displaying. Okay, so here in this topic we will discuss the various purposes for which this embedded systems are designed. Okay, so when you see actually this question, you'll get confused. See, when they ask you the applications, you have to write this. You have to give examples for each and every application. For household appliances, you can give DVD, TV examples. For house automation and security systems, you can give automatic AC. Intrusion detection systems, you can give these examples. For wearable devices, you can give smart bands like that. Okay, they might ask for five marks. Okay, what are the applications? But when they ask you the purpose of the embedded system, so that is a different question. Okay, so when the purpose is with respect to the data collection, storage, and representation, so for that you can give the example as, for example, you can give the camera. Okay, and this question they have asked in the assignment, that is question number 20. Explain the various purposes of the embedded system in detail with illustrative examples. Okay, so this question had been asked for 10 marks, but the thing is in model question paper and also in the previous question papers, so this question I have not asked. So I suggest to, instead of taking this question number 20, this one, you just change the question number 20 to this one, define embedded system and differentiate between the embedded system and general computing system. Is it fine? I'm asking you to change the question number 20 to this one, because this is very important question. Define embedded system and differentiate between embedded system and general computing system. Okay, so for this you just don't write any applications. You just give the definition of the embedded system and give one example, one or two examples, and along with that you just give these differences. Fine. Okay, this question actually just cancel in the assignment anyhow. So as I am telling you, if they ask you the purpose of the embedded system, so for each and every purpose you have to give one example. If they ask for more marks, what you have to do is you have to just explain the functionality of that one. For example, you know, when you see this data collection, storage, representation purpose, for that if you give the example as a camera, so you just have to tell something about the camera, like a camera is an embedded device which is used for the acquisition of the system, and also the storage, and also display, it will display the images in the LCD, and it can be used for the transmission. So like that, you just have to give some explanation about the device, right? Similarly, for example, when you see the monitoring, so you can give the example as an ECG. What does ECG do? It will just use the sensors in order to read the heartbeat, and it will display the heartbeat in the form of a graph in the LCD. Okay, and CRO, as you already know, what is a CRO? It is used in the laboratory purpose, right? So use of the CRO, it is a cathode ray oscilloscope. It is the instrument generally used in the laboratory to display, measure, and analyze the various waveforms of the electrical circuits, right? Like this, you just have to give some explanation about these devices. And when you see this controlling purpose, so you can give the example as the air conditioning systems. So what is the use of this air conditioning systems, automatic air conditioning systems? It contains sensors and actuators. What the sensor will do, it will just read the room temperature continuously, and once it reaches a certain critical temperature, it will just send some electronic signals to the actuators, and the actuator, what it does, it will just do some functionality, some mechanism, okay, like for example cooling the room like this, okay. So you just have to give some explanation about this air conditioning systems. And similarly for the data communication, as it contains network hubs and routers, which contains the end terminals, communicating terminals will be imported with the data communication modules like Bluetooth, ZigBee. Like this, you can give some explanation about this hubs and routers. And similarly, for digital signal processing, you can give the example as a digital hearing aid. You know what it is, right? Actually, it is used by the hearing impaired persons, okay, in order to increase the hearing ability. What it does, it will just receive the voice, and whatever the voice that it has received, it will just filter out the noise, and after filtering the noise, it will just enhance that voice, and after enhancing the voice, that loud voice signals will be sent to the ear, okay. See, as I told you, it might look silly, but the thing is, you just have to give the purpose, and along with it, you just have to give one or two examples, and you just have to explain them, because if it asks for more than 5 marks, definitely you need to just explain that devices, right? So this is the topic. The second topic. Okay, classification. See, actually, this is assignment question, question number 19. This question is also there in the, it is also there in the model question paper. See, when you see the classification of the embedded system, so here the classification, it is based on the two categories. One is with respect to the generation, and another one is with respect to the performance and complexity, right? So when you see the classification based on the generation, it is basically classified into four categories. And all these classifications, when you see the textbook, actually, so he has given it theoretically, it will be difficult for you to remember, okay? So now if you see this in the table form, it will be easy for you to remember, actually, okay? So just this four classifications, the first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation, for each generation, I have given the examples, right? And the classification is based on, depending upon the processor and the microprocessor and the microcontroller you use, okay, whether it's a 8-bit, 16-bit or 32-bit, depending upon that, they have classified. When you see the first generation embedded system, so here they are basically using the 8-bit microprocessors and 4-bit microcontrollers, okay. So for each and every, actually, when you see this 8-bit microprocessor and 4-bit microcontrollers, most of the current embedded devices that you are using in your daily life, so actually we are no longer using this 8-bit, even 16-bit, that is 8086 microprocessor, we are not using that. But still, so it will be better if you give some examples, okay? For an 8-bit microprocessor, the example is 8085, and the 4-bit microcontroller, the example is Z80, okay? You just have to remember this. So here, in the first generation systems, the hardware is very simple, okay? And in most of the embedded systems, so operating system will not be present. So when you see these digital telephone keypads that were used in the old mobile phones, old Nokia phones and Samsung phones, if you see, actually, there will be the digital telephone keypads. See, these keypads, when you press a certain key, for example, when you just press on the 3 button, it will just send you the control signal, and it will actuator will take the corresponding action, okay? There is no requirement of any operating system here, okay? And even the stepper motor also, it does not require any operating system, okay? The stepper motor is available in the laboratory. When you come to the college, I'll just show you. So these things, these are the simple embedded devices. It does not require any operating system, okay? If, for example, a simple electronic toy, if it requires any operating system, so the program for that is designed using the assembly code, you know? Actually, this assembly code, when you see, compared to the high-level language, it is a bit difficult. So when you see this programming, so there are three types, right? One is high level language, assembly language, and another one is machine level language. So machine level language is very tough, only the machines can understand. It's ones and zeros. So this assembly code, okay, so the programs for these type of machines, it is written in the assembly code, okay? So it will be difficult. It's not as easy as the high level language. So when you see the second generation systems, so here they are using the 16-bit microprocessor and 8-bit microcontroller. So 16-bit microprocessor, you can give an example. So here I have not given. So if you want, you can give the example as 8086. And the 8-bit microcontroller, you can give the example as AVR, that is automatic voltage regulator. Okay, so 8-bit microcontroller, you can give an example, that is AVR, automatic voltage regulator. Okay, and when you see this one, they are more powerful and complex than 1G first generation microprocessor and microcontrollers. Yes, of course. Obviously, it will be more complex than that. That's why it is second generation. Okay. And here also, they might contain the operating system. few of them contain the embedded operating system. Yes, most of the systems here, they will contain the embedded operating system. And one of the examples of the second generation system is data acquisition system. Okay. So for data acquisition systems, you can give any example like, you know, ADC and DAC, okay, analog to digital converter and digital to analog converter. So what it does, so for example, when you see the phone, it will contain both ADC and DAC, right? Whatever you're speaking, so this audio, which will be in the analog signal form, it has to be converted into digital form and needs to be transmitted at the receiver end. Again, this digital signals has to be converted into analog form, and it will be converted into analog form. That is the voice, and you can hear that. Okay. So the examples of the data acquisition systems include ADC and DAC. Fine. So next is the third generation system. So in the third generation systems, they will use a 32-bit microprocessor and 16-bit microcontroller. So 32-bit microprocessor, you can give Intel systems. All the Intel processors are 32-bit microprocessors, right? And 16-bit microcontroller, you can give an example as Intel 8096. Intel 8096 is a 16-bit microcontroller, right? And the example include the robotics. Okay, and when you see the fourth generation systems, so here they are using a 64-bit microprocessor and 32-bit microcontroller. Okay, and the example for 32-bit microcontroller is the ARM processor which we are studying, right? So it is an example for 32-bit microcontroller and 64-bit microprocessor. You know, this Intel Quad Core. See, actually, in the fourth generation system, they have started the concept of system on chip and multi-core processors. So here, it will be not working only with the one core. Okay, there will be multiple cores. So this concept have been started in the fourth generation, and this system on chip. Okay, this so whatever the you know functionality. For example, for a system, if it requires the functionality like Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, ZigBee, and all. So all for the required circuitry and the programs, everything will be burnt in a single chip. Okay, so this functionality. The system on chip has been started in the fourth generation systems. And the example they have given as a smartphones, as I have already told you, the smartphones, we cannot tell exactly as, you know, embedded systems. They are more than embedded systems. Okay. Fine. So this is the classification that is based on the generation. And when they ask for 10 marks, you should not tell if they specifically ask classify the embedded system based on the generation, they will ask for 5 marks. So in that case, if you write this table, that is sufficient. But differentiate, they ask for 8 or 10 marks. So what you need to do is you should also give one more classification that is based on the complexity and the performance. Okay. So this is also same. Actually, they have designed as a small scale system, medium scale system, and a large scale embedded system. So these classification, again, it is based on the depending upon the microcontroller, what is the size of the, whether it is 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit microcontroller, microprocessor, whatever they are using, based on this, they have classified. And some of the examples also I have given. A simple electronic toy is an example of a small-scale embedded system. Yes, it may contain the software. If it contains, it is designed using the assembly code. So when you see the medium-scale systems, it includes, you know, the ATM machines. And the examples of the medium scale systems include the ATM machines, okay, and routers for networking. And most of these systems, you know, the medium scale systems, they are developed using the programming languages like C, C++, Visual. Still, you can't hear.